I arrived at Purdue last September and arrived at a period where the university press, which had reported to the Dean of Libraries for many years, was in a period of transition. The Dean of Libraries had made a real commitment to the idea of collaboration and had moved beyond collaboration and hopes to move towards beyond collaboration to integration. So what happened in 2009 was that the university press had moved from the outskirts of campus right into the centre of the library administration, just above the dean's office next to library IT. And that move, the physical move, was very much reflective of this effort to really explore the issues around true integration of a press and a library. And this is an exciting exercise. It has some issues, and one of the main issues is moving from a situation where a university press is part of a wider network of scholarly communication spread over the whole country, is more discipline focused, to one where a university press becomes more institution focused. So the traditional barriers to publishing the work of one's own faculty on an institutional basis are actually crumbling a little bit. And our focus has been changing much more towards providing publishing services for the institution, as opposed to being part of this network spread across the whole system of scholarly communication. And remember, there are 2,500 four-year institutions in North America. I don't know if it's the US or the whole, I think it's the US maybe, 2,500 four-year institutions in the US and only 133 university presses. So it's a slightly new way of thinking about things. So in terms of providing library publishing services, one of the emphases on this of this conference is on the idea of evidence-based and trying to work out what those services should look like based on some form of evidence about what scholars need. And in this context, the data curation profile work that that Scott and colleagues Carol have been working on seems to me to be a powerful starting point for some of the decisions that we're making around publishing, as well as the other aspects of data curation. And clearly, publishing and data curation, as Joyce was saying, there's a continuum there. And what I'm finding particularly interesting is that the librarians, and this was mentioned yesterday, librarians who were thinking of serving faculty as users are now starting to serve faculty as authors. So now that the faculty liaisons particularly are talking to the faculty they serve about data creation, data production, they're thinking like publishers. And so it's much easier for me and my colleagues to have conversations around some of the same issues, intellectual property, access control, all these issues that we were worrying about as publishers. And the data curation profiles are just wonderful ways of having those conversations. Somebody mentioned yesterday, was it Kevin, but the point about MacArthur's quote, that the planning is more important than the plan. And these data curation profiles are a way of having that conversation with my librarian colleagues. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to go out together. I always feel slightly awkward about saying this, but I and the digital collections librarian go out together. And we go out to faculty meetings and we talk as a united whole about the services that the library provides. So that's a rather long introduction to this slide, which is totally stolen from other work that Scott has done. But these are some of the initial ideas that are popping out of the data curation profile work, which, as you can see, is at an early stage still in terms of populating these data curation profiles. So these are maybe rather general ideas, but I think they're very useful in this kind of evidence-based development of library publishing services. So you can see them up here. Let me just go on and deal with each one in turn in terms of how they're starting to influence our decision making. So here's the first message that comes out of the data curation profiles, that researchers want to disseminate outputs, but they're interested in ranges of different types of outputs, in different scopes, different formats, different types of materials. And university presses have traditionally been very based on print books, on subscription-based journals. Also, it has to be said, more in the humanities and social sciences than in the traditional focuses of a university like Purdue, which are technology, agriculture, engineering. And so this is a change in the type of outputs that we're having to think about producing, as well as the subject areas in which we're producing them. So print books and subscription-based journals are not enough. We need to offer a variety of different channels to fit the different needs and ambitions of the faculty and staff on campus. And we need to have the freedom, particularly at this time, to experiment with new models, with open access models, so new business models, new types of output in terms of spatial data being presented in different ways, for example. So we need that that opportunity to experiment. So this is a slide that I stole from J.G. Bankier, who is the president of Berkeley Electronic Press. Berkeley Electronic Press is a journals publisher, but it's also the creator of this software suite, Digital Commons, which is used by several hundred US libraries and international libraries as the basis of a repository, of their repository systems. And I like this slide, which he's termed a continuum of scholarly content, because, again, it's proving to be a very useful way to talk with my colleague, particularly Mark Newton, who's the digital collections librarian, but also with all the faculty liaisons and other colleagues, to talk about how a university press might fit in this library publishing services kind of framework. So what you can see here is, it's a very impressionistic sort of slide, and the stars are put in sort of fairly random places. But you can see that they're plotted on these two axes of scholarly impact on the bottom, going from left to right, and then source of scholarship going up. And so you've got this range of different outputs that the faculty and staff, the outputs of the university, and they range from informal to more formal. And you can see that the red stars here I've put equal Purdue University Press question mark, and the blue stars equal Purdue EPUBs question mark. Now Purdue EPUBs is this Digital Commons repository that Mark Newton runs, and the reason for the question marks around these red stars and around the blue stars is that these are not necessarily types of material that we would publish. So the red stars are not necessarily Purdue University Press outputs, but they're the sort of things we're interested in. So books, clearly, we're interested in publishing those. Faculty journals, maybe. In some cases, yes, we'd be interested. Graduate journals, again, in some cases we've been interested, but in some cases that might be a project that better belongs in the repository. So those are just sort of areas of negotiation. And it gives us, as a press, a rich source of content to sort of pick and choose from. This is a great way of feeding up from different faculty areas interesting projects that we might want to work on. And the blue stars, Purdue EPUBs, there are other questions that Mark Newton will be asking. He's wondering, for example, where to draw the boundary of this being a scholarly collection, this repository content. So, for example, do all administration reports belong in the repository? Maybe it's a very important report of a white paper sort that does belong in the repository, but maybe it's just compensation guidelines or something like that, purely administrative, and maybe that belongs somewhere else. So anyhow, this continuum of scholarly content represents the idea of those outputs and the different types of outputs. So this is a message that we heard so powerfully yesterday from Carol Tenapier, the sum of all question. Researchers are willing to share data with others, but not without certain restrictions or benefits. And this is an area where the press, being part of the libraries, seems to have a particularly useful role, in that when we go out and talk to faculty about the library's services, we are having discussions about publishing rather than about deposit and mandates and all those negative things. So the conversations that we're starting to have with faculty together are much more positive in nature than they were when Mark was going out alone and having to talk about these things that are extra burdens, whereas now with publishing, it's stars light up in people's eyes. This is about this is about benefits to them. It's about prestige. There are some things that we need to be building in terms of the services to actually link this incentivizing publication layer to the data. And data site is so important to us, that ability to be able to link in a way that doesn't break from our publications is just really, really important. And that's why Perdue is so enthusiastic about data site, one of the reasons. One of the things, I was talking about this changed attitude that the librarians have, this change in culture as librarians move to work as publishers, deal with authors as, to deal with faculty as authors. And one of the things that's really changing within the libraries is our attitude to open access. I think it's becoming much clearer to everybody in the libraries that there are certain situations where open access is not necessarily the most logical way of proceeding, that there are real reasons to sometimes control access. So it's a two-way process. This is a conversation that's informing both sides. I just wanted to show this. I mean, I'm talking a lot. I have to confess that we're at an early stage of linking publications and data. And this is a very conventional type of linkage that you'll see all over the publishing world already. But what I'd like to show here is the way in which we are doing that, the continuum of scholarly content. There are links between those blue and red stars as well. And being part of a library system gives us much more flexibility to create those links. So here's this is a book that we're just about to publish. So this is showing our new commitment to technology and engineering as a university press. This is a handbook on demolition. we're just knocking it down. This is building construction management. The Perdue department is number one in the country. And this is a project that we're doing in collaboration with them, but also with a practitioner society. And I think the relationship between societies and libraries is a very interesting one, because they don't have the facilities to put their technical reports and materials like this, whereas we do. And so the National Demolition Association and us are working on this. And so I had the peculiar experience last week of sitting in a room, all little gilt chairs and very, very smart Louis XV sort of type chairs, and these big men sitting on these tiny chairs. And we talked about this book, which they're very, very excited by. So anyhow, one of the things with demolition is, of course, they're on site a lot. And what we're showing here is a little sort of iPhone type screen. But what's interesting is actually they're not using iPhones, it's the screens in their cabs that they're actually getting their information from. But anyhow, a portable device. So the online version of this book, which is available as an ebook, you can read the full text on your portable device. You can click on that little blue link there. That will take you to supplementary data in the EPUBs. Data in the repository. That data is actually spreadsheets, estimating spreadsheets, and then you can download those and do this manipulation. So there's no rocket science here. I mean, everybody's been doing this for ages, but we're doing it in a slightly different sort of way. And the potential is there to do more interesting, not more interesting, but different sorts of things in the future, more ambitious. So this is... this is the lesson number three that was coming out of the data curation profiles. And again, it resonates with what people have talked about yesterday, very interestingly. What is most easily and willingly shared is not always data that has the most reuse value. So again, this is not well expressed, But I mean, I was sensing yesterday this feeling that we're moving away from this emphasis on producing data supplements for publications, so publications, data supplements, to thinking more about maybe how publications can be supplementary to data. So you've got data, and then you've got the publications that are interpreting it, driving use, talking about some of the biases in it. And if this is indeed the case, we are, by using data creation profiles, by going out and involving ourselves early as librarians and publishers, going out together and involving ourselves early in the creation process, we have a unique opportunity to really drive the sharing of useful data. So by being inside the tent, and this is a term taken from an Ithaca report in 2007 on how presses should be moving forward, the unique opportunity that university presses have being on campus and in proximity to the faculty, by being inside the tent, we can have deeper conversations with scholars, looking at their data creation activities, and then developing publications out of that, which actually help them to be confident about sharing the data that's really important. And so Scott and I, a few weeks ago, we had a meeting with a recipient of a large NSF grant, the National Earthquake Engineering,
Network for Earthquake Engineering Simulation.
Yes, a Network for Earthquake Engineering Simulation, which is a multi-university consortium with a center at Purdue. And that was a conversation at the start of their grant, and the question was, you have all this interesting data, what could be an interesting publication that sort of comes out of that data to help drive usage of that? So that's a new kind of conversation that we can have with this relationship with the libraries. So these are some next steps that we're thinking about. Clearly, and IMLS's new grant with the workshops is going to really facilitate this. The spreading of the use of data creation profiles is really important because we need more information from more different sorts of faculty to come into this big database of faculty behavior. And what strikes me from our conversations yesterday as particularly valuable about the data creation profiles is what they have the capacity to reveal is subdisciplinary variation in behavior. So I think we've seen a lot of reports, not from people in this room, but I'm thinking of the Center for the Study of Higher Education at Berkeley, the work that they've done on different disciplinary groups. We've seen a lot of information that's almost too general to be useful because it doesn't drill down to those subdisciplinary variations. And with the data creation profiles, because the faculty liaisons are going out and dealing with individuals and talking about their own discipline with no preconceptions about what that discipline should look like, we're going to have this welling up of interesting information about subdisciplinary variation. And another aspect which I think is very interesting, thinking back to some of the work being done at University of Rochester by people like Susan Gibbons on ethnographic analyses of what people are doing, as well as what they're saying, is that here we have the faculty liaisons being harnessed, people actually on the ground going out and being able to observe what the faculty are actually doing, as well as what they're telling us that they're doing. And I think that's such a wonderful thing about the data creation profiles. Second thing, we need to be able to articulate better the types of services we can provide to faculty and staff at Purdue. So Mark and I will go out and we'll start having these conversations, and what we'll find after a while is, this is very interesting, but I have a grant proposal due at the end of the week. I'd like to include you in it. I'd like to include you for data management. I'd like to include you for publishing. How much do you want? How much money do you want? And that information needs to be at the tip of our fingers. We need to be able to go with the price list. Right. You know, 70 megabytes, et cetera, et cetera. This is how much it will cost. And I know this is a conversation we were having with Mike when he was at Purdue a few weeks ago. So more clearly defining library-based publishing services and building these relevant skills and tools is going to be one of our emphases. And in fact, we have a grant application together with University of Utah and Georgia Tech into an IMLS program at the moment, library-based publishing services strategies for success. And then finally, this is kind of new, and what we do run up against is kind of old perceptions of what a library and what librarians should be doing, and also what a publisher, and especially university presses, should be doing. And so with university presses, you know, we were only of concern to the College of Liberal Arts. I mean, we're a humanities thing, we're a social sciences thing. So we have to change that perception and show how we can add value to certain types of publication, how we operate within this web of other types of publishers, scholarly societies, commercial publishers, and how we can fit in and provide some unique services within that network. And with the libraries, of course, this complete change from thinking about collections being defined by collections to being defined by services. So this is a process of going out there, not sitting within one's office, but being out there on site with the faculty. Again, another reason why data creation profiles are such great tools. So I think that's all I have to say. This is Scott's slide to indicate that this is new, and are we just howling at the moon, or are we actually going to have be able to jump off the cliff and bring back some carrion?
We're going on all the time, but we want to move on. Any questions for clarification? Chris Batt has a question for clarification.
Charles, you made a statement about open access.
Well, I think it's some of the it's some of the examples that were coming up yesterday in terms of a situation where there is I come from a background of archaeology, so the situation of identifiable sites in a valley that you don't want people to necessarily go in and loot, you know, or embargoed information in terms of information that is commercially sensitive. It's interesting meeting some of the Purdue faculty how information that we might not think immediately is commercially sensitive. So from disciplines and sciences that seem very kind of pure and not applied, still a number of steps down the line, that is going to be a commercially sensitive piece of information. But I mean, in general, we publish 6 open access journals, and we're really pushing the boundaries on open access and believe in it passionately. It's just, it's not a tool for